Hello, welcome to the Dance Worka Podcast, and this is the Dance as a Career series, episode 2, titled Possible Career Paths Within Dance. I'm L'Edima, the creative director of Danceville Entertainment. Danceville Entertainment is a dance theme production company. We create content for stage, video, TV, and large scale productions in arenas and stadiums. We also run a studio and a facility that also trains individuals in different creative activities, dance primarily, and then management and some other things that we'll go into later. So like I said, this is episode 2, possible career paths within dance. And as I mentioned in the first episode, the career is a series of jobs that outline progressive growth within an industry. And today we are trying to work out how to line up those jobs, how to plan the lineup of those jobs so that you can get a worthy or a successful career within the dance activity and leverage on training and opportunities that are available wherever you find yourself. So rather than list possible careers that are available within dance, I will talk about how to combine the careers already available. And if you really want to know more about the careers, you could follow me on my Instagram handle, L'Edima. So there will be captioning daily descriptions of different dance careers and dance jobs. But on this podcast, we're working out how to arrange these dance jobs so that it's profitable to you and you could witness and experience growth. Last week, I asked you to think about the big picture, the end, what you want to achieve at the end of it all, who you want to be at the end of it all. Would you be a renowned choreographer, or would you own your own dance facility? Would you be a popular performer? Whatever it is, we had asked you to identify, think about and identify that. And that will come into play now, because once you have the end and we know where you are at the beginning, the idea of a path is to draw a line from the beginning to that end. Now, like I said also, plans is all we have. We could plan and then work towards those plans. And as you go on in the working of the plans, more things unfold. So plans are also allowed to change. But it's better to have a plan you're working with than to just leave everything to chance. Draw out or bring out whatever you wrote your end game on last week, and the way you answered the questions that you were asked last week about what you want to do with yourself, with your life and your career. Well, I want to believe I'm talking to three kinds of people. One, those who haven't yet started, people who are thinking of considering dance. Two, people who have already started and are somewhat not sure, or possibly even sure of where they want to go, but they have at least started, done their training, started taking some jobs. And three, people who have somewhat established themselves in a particular section or sector within dance, and are trying to work out a transition from where they are to the next level. So those are the major people. There's also a chance that I'm talking to people who are not necessarily dance-oriented, but just want to try and apply what we are doing in the things that they're already working on. So questions you have to ask yourself, or things you need to work out at the beginning, is what parts in dance, what about it interests you the most? What draws your attention the most? Whatever level you are, whatever of the three levels I mentioned, what intrigues you the most? Is it the movement? Is it the applause? Is it the starstruck look in people's eyes who have seen you perform before? Is it the satisfaction of seeing something you created being appreciated? Is it the behind the scenes of, you know, running and organizing and putting things together? Are you a good manager? Do people listen to you? You need to find out who you are, first of all, what works for you. Are you better with materials than with human beings? Do you create things, maybe like you put together the clothes, put together the sets that people dance with? When you do create your dances, the props and things they work with, are they spectacular? Are they different from what the regular average dancer choreographer works with? That's the first question you need to find out. What moves you the most? What within dance moves you the most? Do you explain projects better? Are you a good speaker? Do you talk about your work well, other people's work or work you're involved in well? Do people follow jobs or follow productions because you are on it? That is, no matter how small or how irrelevant it seems to be. But like I said, when you ask yourself questions, you have to be very honest with the answer, because these answers are for you. It really doesn't concern anybody. So what works for you most? What about dance intrigues you the most? Are you good with publicity? Are you good with gaining attention? So ask that, confirm that, because with that, then we now know how or what you will build within with that special interest or that special activity. So you now have to compare if that special interest you have aligns with the end picture you had created last week. Do they align? Do they have a role to play with each other? Like, for example, you gain a lot of satisfaction when you realize people appreciate work you have created. So meaning you're looking at choreography, and then your end picture doesn't have anything that includes the concept of choreography. You may need to revisit the picture. Yes. But then you do like choreography, so meaning you need to understand not just movement but quality of movement. You also need to understand when we dance a lot, there are some people who dance without emotion, which isn't really acceptable in most times. But then the concept of choreography is used everywhere, in a lot of places, not just in dance. So we have people who choreograph stunts for movies or for stage shows. We have people who choreograph dramas. We have people who choreograph parades. So if you do have an interest in choreography, and as you're looking at maybe being endgame, a renowned choreographer, someone with amazing work, a lineup of works added to your name. But you know that as you go on, you have to work out creating your own business at the end of the day. But then the career path you're drawing up has to be a path of jobs within choreography. So you will definitely, yes, start off as a dancer, start off performance to understand the feeling of the dancers and what they go through and how the dances are done, and then convert that experience to actually creating. And then you could start by creating small groups, maybe children's school classes or recitals, and then grow up maybe for music videos, and then move from there. We all know there are different levels of music videos, and then okay. So if you're going to be creating choreographing for video, you know that's different from choreographing for stage. So if you're heading the line of video, you grow within the videos to movies and so on. But if you're interested in stage, you also have to make sure you're grounded in the concept of theater as well, as much as of dance. So those are two different paths, but with the same focus or interest in choreography. Now, because the number of jobs available in Nigeria dance-wise are not as many as some countries, there's a need to diversify. It's hard before you find someone who focuses on a specific kind of craft. But it's best if we try and at least know what primary is. Because some people choreograph for arenas. I met a lady who choreographs outdoor performances in London. And that's what she does, outdoor performances. And I didn't even know that was what it was called. So apart from, and it's not necessarily dance, it's performance. They parade, they walk, they with amazing props. But what she does, the props and the things she builds are specifically for outdoor. So it's used in festivals. So my work with her was supposed to involve the dance in those parades. You need to be able to identify what your primary is and then build a profile within that primary, bearing in mind that our industry in Nigeria is growing and you should grow with it. And the good thing about existing now is that we get to set the tone of what the industry will eventually be. So we need to grow with it and then create the options that are available to grow into, which is more than what most people can do in other industries. Most people have already met a precedent and they have to follow what is there, but we get to design, we get to create what it will be and what it can be. Most industries, the career paths are within a particular organization. So it's a vertical movement within a particular organization or across from one organization to another or one function to another. So you get in an organization at entry level and grow into operations, into management, and into leadership. Now, that brings me to the point of organizations, why there's a need for actual dance-themed businesses. If the organizations are not there, you're just going to have a lot of freelance people doing things in their own names without any purpose of certain growth. But organizations provide structure. It also provides a platform for people who begin to learn, to grow within. Example, I mean, if you just concluded training, or maybe to train, you have to work with an organization, either a dance school or, like in Nigeria, most dance groups take in members and they learn by doing. They do as they do. They learn by affiliation. That is still an organization. That's still also a form of training, apart from the formal concept of a school or studio classes where people go and learn. And these are organizations that are housing people. And it was the strength of those organizations are determined by the amount of time, amount of success and failing stories, and the number of people who either are within or have passed through those organizations. So with the organizations in place, people have what to grow in or grow through. I keep telling studio owners and dance group heads that chances are no one will stay with you forever. You have to accept that fact, that no matter how awesome or how useful an individual is with you, just so that the person at some point in time would have a dream of their own, they would want to leave you and pursue. So your policies and activities should be designed in a way that when it's time for that person to leave, you don't feel like something has been stolen from you. That's why schools have school fees, so that you train, you graduate, you go, the next coming train, graduate, they go. And for dance organizations that accept people for free, usually have a system where you serve and gain money for the organization before you leave. But there's been a lot of friction when people get or need to leave before the organization feels like they have served enough. Let's not go into that in detail, but the point is there's a need for organizations to be in place and the organizations to be clear on what they are and what they do, no matter how many things they do. So an individual comes in maybe as a trainee, or they've already trained somewhere else and they come in and want to start working with you. The organization provides a platform for them to actually gain this experience, actually at your cost. Because if you're a beginner, chances are that you may not be able to afford to organize your own show. But the organization you are with will put up shows, and you gain experience from the shows that have been organized by that organization. And sometimes probably get paid for being part of their production. It's the same thing with established names who get jobs. Now, nobody knows you. Nobody knows who you are, what you can do, but they probably know your boss. So your boss gets jobs, and then you tag along and build a name for yourself or a name within the organization to a point where your boss probably trusts you to handle certain things on your own. I also want to say that you need to be clear on who or what you are within that organization, because there's been a lot of stories about backstabbing and, should I say, job snatching, which is not fair across board. It's not fair to you as as a dancer is not fair to the organization that you're working with. It's also not fair to the client because chances are that you don't have the experience the client is looking for. You do the job shabbily and it reflects badly on the entire industry because that job had been paid for. We need to understand the value of the organizations and see to it that the organizations stand. So I mentioned earlier that you have to be considering a business of your own. So even if your end goal or end game is something that you can do as an individual without people attached to you, to truly, truly give back or grow, you have to set up a system whereas people work with you. They learn from you, you give back. And honestly, it gives a sense of satisfaction because you get to do less. So the growth, for those of you who are not sure of how or where to grow, the easiest way is by affiliating with an organization or affiliating with an already existing brand. That way you get to learn some of the things that are being done, things that you're not necessarily taught in school. Get to understand the different levels and things that are required, and then you gain the necessary experience that you can fall back on in future when you're doing things on your own. So in 2016 or 2017, I produced my first full-length movie, feature movie, and it was the first time I was dealing with actors, as in on a movie set actually. It was a large set because we had a cast and crew of, as in total, it came to 112 people that were on that set. And for the average Nigerian movie, that was a lot of people. But because the movie had singing and dancing, we needed people to fill up certain spaces. And it was an epic movie, so there were a lot of crowd scenes. So it was, in fact, that was the study of my life, because it's then you realize the value of a system. We had to work with pro movie makers to get this done. And so they came up, they informed us on, should I say, rules and what is expected at different levels. Everybody on set knew what their role was. People picking the wires, the people handling the microphones, people handling the lights. You know, everybody knew their role. The costumers, the continuity guy, the gaffer, everybody knew what and where they were supposed to be. Then the production manager to all, in fact, that was the biggest job on set, up and about. And then the people in charge of costumes, like I said, it was a large set. So the costume line was a really big one. I made most of the costumes that were used, but then the creating the costumes and the assigning and the arrangement of its use on set were two different things. So they insisted, I knew I was going to make the costumes, but the director kept on insisting that we needed to hire a costumier, someone who had experience in costuming movies. So I went along with him, and even though I made the costumes, I got someone. And that was when I realized that making the costumes is one thing, but the process of getting people dressed and for which scene and what scene was a different ballgame entirely. And that's why the movie industry is what it is. That's why it's called an industry. In fact, that was when I realized that there was a gap. There were a lot of gaps in the dance industry that needed filling. So there were people, all of them had the script, all of them knew what was expected of different people. So the makeup guy knows, okay, fine, for this scene, get your costumes first of all before I put up this makeup. And then there were certain scenes where the costume said, no, for this scene, you should get your makeup first. And there were few arguments on those things. And then the guy in charge of continuity, in fact, at first I thought what he did was magic, but going on, as we did more movies, I got to understand that there was a certain skill behind getting that job done. So it then brings you back to the dance and you realize the gaps within dance, where we don't have people specializing in certain things. In fact, I had to pull some of them from the movie, from the movie into what we do at Danceview, so that they could also help out and help us get some of these things done. You realize that there are roles to be played, things to be done, and there are specific ways these things should be done. And within dance, the opportunities are limitless because there's so much that isn't done yet. And you could just a little research, you could find out what and how to channel what you do. There aren't many dance themed movies from Nigeria. And as people start doing those movies, there is a need for people to know how it's done. Now, the movie was only possible because I had to actually work with people from the film, and I argued with them along the line because there are many things concerning the dance scenes that the director argued with me about, and I had to insist and put my foot down that some of them happened. But then after doing that movie, we now went back to the studio and started doing short movies on our own to try and sharpen our skills so that we don't have to fight with the director with what is important. To him, the dance scenes were almost stressful, so he preferred to reduce them. But for us, the movie was about the dance. So we fought back and forth. But right now, dance, we have people who are started directing things, short movies. And the next time we do our own feature movie, we know we will blow the world. And that's because we understand, we know what we want to primarily showcase. And we are hoping we find, rather than look for a director who understands that, we are raising a director who can. If not just one, a lot of us are doing different things, small different ways, but we intend to fill that gap one way or another. We are calling on other people to do that as well. As you grow within the organization you are in, you also need to find out the jobs that are available in that organization and the job requirements that are needed for that job, and put that beside the kind of training or experience you have. Now, like I had mentioned, choreography and stage. Most dance training facilities in Nigeria don't necessarily train or teach theater generally. People who know more about theater are the theater troops and the people in the universities studying theater or studying dance in the universities. So if you're interested in theater, and thank God for Lagos and the growth of theater shows and theater productions that include. If you're interested in choreographing for theater, it's important that you understand theater. So you could either understand by being a part of, or by actually going for training or understudying someone who is already choreographing for theater. With dance, there are a lot of options. So when you're planning growth in that direction, you need to consider this. Your training never truly stops at the beginning. You have to keep training to equip you for the next level. So you've done your dance training, you've started taking dance jobs, started dancing on stage, started dancing in certain productions. In fact, by dancing in stage musicals, it's easy to understand most of the terminology because you're already in that world. But then I always recommend that you learn by affiliating with people who have already done what you've done. The truth is that you will learn faster. You will learn faster because the hurdles you would have had to jump learning on your own, you're standing on the shoulders of someone who has already jumped over them. So you tell you ahead of time, don't do this way. Do that this way. And you can't, I keep saying, you can't lead if you haven't followed. So work with someone. Gain the necessary experience, work with an organization, align yourself with somebody who looks like where you are going. I told you to put those names down last week, so I'm sure you should have names of people who look like what you want to do. Now, when I say people who look like, it's best if you don't have the necessary resources to try and find those people locally. Find them around you. I'm saying this because maybe in a place like Nigeria, you're listening to me from a small town somewhere, you decide that the people who look like what you want to do are somewhere in Lagos, and then you up and move. As much as that is not a bad thing, I'm saying it doesn't have to be. There is someone around you you can start with so that you don't arrive at the big city like a Johnson. Start somewhere. Start with people around you. Don't talk down the pros in. Because I keep saying, I live in New York. Compared to certain cities, Uyo is considered a small city. And from my small city, I have been able to influence and affect people from other big cities. I've been able to get access to people in other big cities. I also brought some of them to Uyo. So And then we have a lot of amazing people in New York who do amazing, great things. And it didn't seem fair to just leave them out of the group plan, the things we are doing, because we are in a small city. In fact, I'm not even sure we can call you a small city anymore. It's growing really fast. But bottom line, it's not every time you have to up and travel. Now, I recommend that you leave your town once in a while so that you see what people are doing in other places. Come back energized and, you know, be able to, you apply that. That's how you learn. You go, you come back. I do that a lot. I leave, come back, and then implement the things I've seen in other places and other cities. So you need to affiliate with an organization or a person who is doing what you want to do. In fact, by affiliating with these people, you will see the options available in the field or the path that you're interested in. Now, as I said at the beginning, this is possible career paths in dance, and this is part one. And the only way to get the best out of this particular episode and be able to actually draw a clear career path is if you have information that has not yet been shared. That's why it's divided into two parts. We are going to take on jobs, we'll take on businesses available, and then we will now come back to possible career paths in dance part two. And at the end of part two, we are sure that you'll be able to draw a visible, clear plan of what you would want to do with yourself within dance. You are going to ask yourself the following questions. One, what are the experiences you have? What's your current skill set? What can you do? That's the question. What's your current skill set? Now, this skill set doesn't have to necessarily be dance-wise. I have a few friends who had degrees in medical sciences. You know, and then they have training in dance. And then they combine the two of them and then come up with something or some. So when I say skill set, I don't mean what dance style do you do? I mean, what do you do generally? There's one of my dancers who builds furniture. And endgame, I know he's going to do a lot of awesome set design because he builds furniture and he draws amazingly. And he's also an awesome choreographer, but he's still young. So he's still building those skills, all three of them. And at the end of the day, as we go on with the name and everything he has built within these sectors, we're looking at set design, which I know he would excel in. So what's your skill set? There's a dancer I admire so much in Nigeria who has training in physiotherapy. And so she does a lot of dance therapy, dance themed therapy, dance fitness themed activity. And that's because she has training in both fields. I have a dancer who just came back from law school, and she has been working with me on some of our legal activities here, in setting up our foundation and setting up our legal structure within Danceville as well. So what's your skill set? What do you do? What experience do you have? What training do you have? You have to write that down. And it may not be a long list. It doesn't have to be. But if it's a long list, it's not a problem. Okay, secondly, considering the job growth, yes, using the end picture you had put in place and also the one you had reviewed, if you had to review your end picture, considering job growth, what requirements do you need? Because if you're considering owning a facility, it means there should be some level of management. You should understand some level of management. So what requirements do you need? Not necessarily immediately, but you have to put that in that plan so that as at the point of transition, you know you have that lockdown. So what requirements do you need? Considering where you are going, what do you need to know how to do? Business-wise, you really don't have to know everything. Sometimes things are easier done by affiliating with someone who already does that. But the world is changing. We know what it's like now with the whole COVID issue. The world is changing. And there's a lot of do-it-yourself going on, a lot of trainings on how to do everything. And so a lot of companies are downsizing, reducing the number of people they used to do things. So I actually do recommend that you do have an idea of most of the things involved in what you want to do. What requirements are needed. So you need to find out what is it you need to know, what skill you need to have, or you need to add, or you need to convert to achieve that end game that you're looking for. If you're not sure, you could Google. Google is your friend. All right. So what requirements, what do you need to know? And thirdly, do I have a portfolio? Now, I had been doing shows and creating projects. I'd been part of different shows for years before I started building a portfolio, and that's one of the biggest regrets I have. And there are different ways these portfolios can be designed. It could be in pictures, but for dance and what we do, we recommend videos. And thank God for social media. I mean, Facebook could store this for you. Instagram could store these things for you. It could be called up anytime you need. But you need to create a system of documentation of the work you do. It also shows you how your work has improved or decreased, or you could check out your growth pattern by reviewing the jobs you've done. So portfolios include works you've done, works you have featured in, works you have. I also have a file of works that I'm planning to do, and things I'm planning to do haven't exactly created yet. But you have to have some form of portfolio. If you don't have one, you have to start off one. Try and get clips and videos of things you have done before. Start building a portfolio. Not necessarily to use now, but to use. You never know when those works will be called for or called for. So you start building your portfolio. Do you have one? If yes, awesome. Continue the building. If no, start building one. Start now. Start documenting your growth. Start documenting your projects. Start documenting your involvement. I have this phobia against pictures and videos. So most of the time I'm at events, and then I realized I didn't take one picture, except maybe the event pictures, and then they now send them to me. I'm like, okay, yeah, well, I'm getting over it. But the thing is, you have to start documenting. You can't run away from it. You have to be able to show what you've done and where you've done. It also helps with building a resume of some sort. It's easier that way. People you've done things with, and there's proof of the things you have done. Now, I want to say this at the beginning. I'll say this now, and it's especially for those who are young in the industry, those who are probably just entering, or those who have started maybe midway. Be careful not to burn bridges. Be careful not to burn bridges. A lot of times we get so carried away with the attention we get, and we think nobody else matters. Especially if maybe you're working for somebody who is a little quiet, a little not very vocal about how he or she feels on certain issues. You have to be careful not to burn bridges, because you're as valuable as your network. There are people I cannot recommend for anything, and because I know I would only recommend a person who will not be troublesome. It's easy for me not to take a person who doesn't come to me by recommendation. Yes. Now, while I had mentioned you should start building a portfolio, and I also mentioned you should be part of an organization. But while you're part of that organization, it's important that your availability or your presence in that organization does not sabotage the organization or its brand. I'm saying you have to be true to the brand that you are a part of. So let's say you're an XYZ company, and you're building profile, you're posting things, you're talking about your dance activity, and you keep talking about it as NDA. And meanwhile, you're using XYZ resources and posting and promoting as NDA, which is not fair, because your affiliation with that organization has to add to the organization, even if it's with your small Instagram post. and then you go out and you take meetings and take appointments as a different name, yet you're part of another organization. Things like that gives your affiliation a sour taste in the mouth. And so people don't talk, they don't say anything, but just let it go. And then when you say you're leaving, you now leave and you feel like you are leaving with an already existing brand because you built the brand within somebody else's brand. Now that's something that has been going on, which is really not fair to both the young and the old. So you now find people reluctant to give younger people chances because of the chances they had given someone who abused it. Your value in that organization has to be felt and has to be true. If you really feel it is time to build as yourself, walk up to management and tell them it's time to leave and then go. That way you still remain friends, and if something comes up, they could still work with you. I'll tell a quick story about a young man who came to serve in Uyo, and he came to see me. He came with a CV, a long list of people he has worked with in Lagos, and I'm like, cool, but we don't have any space right now. We're not taking anybody. And he left. Then I went to Lagos for a Spirit of David show, and love it. I sent someone to you and you didn't take the person. And I'm like, no, you didn't. She said, yeah, she mentioned his name. Like, he didn't tell me you sent him. She said she did, and that he mentioned that I said I didn't have any space. So I called him. Did Lovett send you? He said, yes. I said, why didn't you just say so? He was quiet. I said, you could, that's all. I know Lovett. Lovett is a friend of mine, and I know she wouldn't send someone who would be a problem. I would make provision for someone she sent. It's the same way I would send someone to her, and I expect her to know that I won't send the problem as well. So he's not the only one who has come to me on recommendation from somebody else. And I've also sent people to other people recommending, yes, this person is no longer with me, but he could do a lot more, do a lot with you, could do more. Sometimes they move up, sometimes move up on their own. So you need to be careful not to burn bridges. And even when for some reason there's a misunderstanding, I have a misunderstanding with another practitioner, I try to find a way to fix it. Sit down. What's the problem? What went wrong? It's not what I meant. And it's not because I'm stupid, but because it's a small world. You never know. And yes, you have people who backstab, but it shouldn't be you. Make sure your hands are clean enough so that you could eat with the elders. I keep saying people that I'm affiliated, the people I affiliate with, most of them are way ahead of me in the industry. And some people think or rate me in their level because I work with them. But it's just because I've remained friendly, I've remained nice, and I've remained loyal. So try now. Be careful. Do not burn bridges. You have a problem with that boss and you want out. Find a way to get out without fighting. Give them a gift. Tell them it's time and leave. Do not burn bridges. Okay. So next week, we'll be talking about jobs available within dance. We hope you tune in and we hope you learned something, a thing or two from today's podcast as well. Like I said, this is Possible Career Paths in Dance Part 1, and Part 2 will be coming up after we've set certain things in place so you can use that to draw a proper path for yourself. Thank you.